Maybe Yvon, if you like, maybe we can start here, right? What about you?
Okay.
Okay. So today I'm very pleased to introduce Yvon Madet. He will talk about construction, calibration, and validation of macroepidemiological.
Épidémiologique, yes, sir.
It's a typo. Epidemiological surveillance indicator at national level from wasted water analysis. So please, Yvon.
Okay, thank you, Pierre. Thank you for the invitation, and thank you for hosting this series of lectures. So, yes, so I will speak about what we are doing in the wastewater plants in order to understand and to see how the epidemic is evolving in France and also in other countries, as you will see at the end of the presentation. So this is a joint work. This is a joint work made in the frame of the réseau Aubépine. Aubépine is for observatoire dans les eaux usées. And I will speak about what is in this paper with many authors, because this is an interdisciplinary project where there are mathematicians, epidemiologists, biologist as well, and it recently appeared in Environment International. So first of all, what is Réseau Aubépine? So it is an interdisciplinary research group aiming at defining a macro epidemiological indicator from wastewater analysis. Okay, so it is based on six main steps. First of all, we realized in March 2020, so it's already 2 years ago, that we were able to qualify the presence of the gene of the virus in the wastewater. And we were able to qualify it at a very low limit of detection. We were also able, which is maybe all of much importance as well, we were able to quantify it, to quantify the concentration of the trace of the virus, indicating that, so in March 2020, the level of circulation of the virus in the Paris area was increasing, and we could see it from what was going on in the wastewater. And after the lockdown, we were able also to see that it was going down, so proving really that it was related to the epidemiological status. So, of course, when you do measurements in such a nasty place like the wastewater, you get a large number of errors inherent to the measure in biological media. And so the plan was also to minimize the effect of the error in order to get a reliable indicator of tendency. So there was at this stage, of course, a lot of mathematical work in order to understand what are these errors and how we could get rid about them. There was also mathematical statistical work based on the statistics of polls in order to select out of the 22,000 treatment plants, wastewater treatment plants, we choose a smaller number between 100 and 200, as I will explain. So there was also some work at this stage in order to select what are the best place to do the analysis. And because now we are currently doing this on a large number and twice a week, large number of stations, we need to involve a large number of laboratories. And due to the error and the fact that the laboratories don't use exactly the same number of steps, then we had to homogenize in order to propose a nationwide indicator. So I will explain you this in what is arriving. So currently we are following 200 wastewater treatment plants. These are the places where they are done. The color indicates which laboratory is working on this, since we are working on 9 different laboratories. Of course, we go and pick the water in the treatment plants, and this is integrated sampling on 24 hours, where every 10 minutes or so, the system is taking a little bit of water that arrives in the wastewater in order to have the representation of what arrives in one day. This is done twice a week, and we are selecting by RT-PCR the E and the RD-RP genes, and the reports are sent every week to the collectivities and also to the sanitary agencies and the Ministry of Research, for instance. Naturally, now we are also looking at the variants, try to quantify the variants, the alpha, the delta, and now the omicrons. So for the quantification, I will not explain you what is done at the biological level, but at the mathematical aspect, what we get is concentration. And we have to normalize this concentration, taking into account additional data, that allows to get a different quality index of the indicator that we propose. For instance, of importance, of course, because we get concentration, we need to have the volume of wastewater reaching the wastewater treatment plant. And we also have to include, when it is available, a factor that modifies a little bit the concentration when there is a lot of rain, for instance. So a factor that takes into account more closely the size of the population. So for instance, the ammonium, the conductivity, normalized by their mean dry value. So now comes the mathematical process. So we have developed a Kalman smoothing algorithm for the data that we get in the wastewater treatment plant. And it is based on an autoregressive process from which we observe only noisy and censored version of the data.
Okay,
so could you close your microphone? So here, what we are interested in is not on the concentration, but on the logarithm of the concentration for two reasons. The first one is that we are looking at an autoregressive process. So taking the logarithm of the population is more in line with having this low for the autoregressive process. So this is the true process that we want to recover. And having XII meaning the day and XI minus one meaning the day before, going from XI minus one to XI through a multiplication by eta plus delta is more in line with an exponential behavior of the population, which is a very simplified analysis behavior of the evolution of the population, of course. So we use this on the logarithm of the concentration, and also because the errors, the positive error and the negative error are not of the same size. There is some heterostaticity in the errors, and so taking the logarithm allows to have a better representation of homostaticity. And so here, XI is the true process that we want to recover. And what we get is YI, which is the a polluted, a noisy representation of the true process, plus some censoring because there is the problem of limit of detection. So in order to let you understand a little bit better what we are doing and what we are recovering, let's assume that between March and January, this is the true presence of the logarithm of the concentration, which we don't know, of course. This is just to illustrate the presentation. So these are the true measures through March to January. And of course, we get measurements of this. So we get noisy data. Okay, let me go back to the exact data. So you see that we are measuring with a certain kind of error. And there are three types of errors. So the first one is the positive and the negative error with respect to the true, what you can see, for instance, between March and May. Between May and July, there is a very low concentration. So we are not able to measure at these low values. And what we get is the limit of detection. So we don't know what is the precise or even noisy data below 20 because the limit of detection is 20. And there are other errors that are aberrant here, that are erroneous completely. And that are the light blue in my presentation, which are due to the fact that either at the level of the wastewater treatment plant or at the level of the laboratory or at the level of the writing in the databases, the values, an error was there, and these should not be taken into account. But of course, we don't know this, okay? So this is what gives the treatment through what I said here, the autoregressive process, the Kalman filter, the red part, if we don't take into account the fact that we have a limit of detection and erroneous data. And this is what we get if we include in the process, in the treatment, in the Kalman filter, the fact that limit of detection means that the values are below the limit of detection. And you see on the same plot here, the red curve that we are reconstructing and the green that we will never know. And you see that it's quite good. And in particular, the green, the true value is in the incertitude neighborhood at 95%. Of course, the Kalman filter backward and forward is going from March to January and then back from January to March in order to provide a reliable curve that represents the true data. This is what we are able to propose in January. But of course, if you look at the value in July, September, or November that we plot here, these values proposed for July take into account data that come after the month of July. So what were we able to propose in July? This is what we show here, where you see that the light blue-greenish value that stops at July is not on the top of the previous red curve, because the red curve here is taking into account the values that are given later. But you see that the tendency is quite good. And there is an uncertainty on the last week of July, but not more. It is the same in September. And actually, there is almost no error between the value that we are able to propose in September and the value that we are able to propose now. And about the same in December, where you see that the orange is on the top of the red, except at the last week, where there is a little bit of difference. But the trend, the tendency is quite well represented here. The limit of detection, I said, was the point that was important. For instance, assume that with the same data, we have a limit of detection which is not anymore at 20, but at 24. Okay. So assume that you have a protocol that is doing the analysis of the concentration in the wastewater, but it is not so precise, not so accurate, and this leads to a limit of detection which is at the level of 24. Okay, so you see that between May and September, there is all the values are at the limit of detection, and this is what we are able to propose with the Kalman filter. So actually, it's not too bad with these bad values, bad evaluation of the concentration. But of course, it is not as good as when we have a limit of detection of 20, where, for instance, in June, we are already able to say, "Aha, it is starting to increase." Okay, if we look at this result, of course, we are not able to say anything. So this is what we do on the data that arise from one wastewater treatment plant coming from one of the laboratories. Of course, we had to normalize among the different laboratories, and to do this, we organized inter-lab qualification and also quantification. So the qualification, we organized this process for 25 different laboratories. Out of each 10 were selected because the other 15 were not able to provide limit of detection that were accurate enough. And we gave them three similar samples. And of course, they should have given us similar values. And some of the 15 laboratories were not giving us the same values for these three labs. Okay, the other part is about the quantification. So now we know that the 10 selected laboratories are able to provide an accurate value. We want to inter evaluate the different laboratories, and this is the repartition of the data, where you see that for instance the laboratories number 6 and 5 are giving values that are slightly higher than laboratory number 3, for instance. Okay, and due to this, we were able to take this into account and provide comparable treatment over the whole network. That allows now us to give like a meteorologic map of the presence of the virus in the wastewater, where you see, for instance, when you get more reddish, the level of concentration is higher, and the little arrow is providing over 7 days what is the evolution of the situation. We were able also to compare the red curve that we propose, the indicator, with the incidence rate in different cities. And you see that it is quite remarkable. For instance, you see that in Nice, the first on the top left, the two curves are almost coincident, which is the incidence rate taken out of individual testing and the wastewater treatment plant, which is only one measure representing the area of the city of Nice. And you see that almost everywhere you have a very good coincidence between the indicator, where our indicator being quite like in the Richter scale, saying that when you have a level of above 100, then it's really an important level of circulation. And when you are below 50, it's a low level of circulation. And so of interest, of course, is to compare these two indicators, one based on only one measurement in the wastewater and the other one based nowadays out of about 9 to 10 million of measurements that are individually taken. Okay, so of interest also is to see if there is a lag between what is can be seen in the wastewater treatment plant and the individual indicator. And due to this, we looked at the second wave and the third wave, the lag between the two indicators. And here is what is represented. You see that most of the stations have a lag, which is a positive lag. Some of the stations giving 6 days ahead, some giving 2 days ahead. And for instance, Nancy, for reason that may be due to the wastewater treatment plant, or also to the fact that the indicator is the individual indicator, the incidence rate is not accurate enough. So in some sense, out of Nancy, there is a lag of -4, -5 days, okay? Of importance also is to know if it is worth, it is sufficient to look only twice a week in the wastewater treatment plant. Should we look every day? Should we look every 3 days a week? So this is what we were able to do out of treatment plants in Reims, where we are currently getting the sample every day. So from the sample every day, we were able to propose a curve, and now we degrade the data by taking not all the values, but only 3 days a week or 4 days a week. And we see that, so if you keep on the left plot, if you look at the 6 days, you get a very good representation with respect to the 7 days. It is the same for 5, 4, and 3. Two is still valid, but the difference between 2 and 2' is the fact that in 2, you may get 2 days consecutive, and 2', you don't choose this, you choose at least that you have 2 days in between. Okay, so you see that it would be better to get three samples a week, but for reason of budget, twice a week seems to be enough. And of course, if you take only one, you are not very good, and there is a large deviation. Even if the average is quite good, the deviation is too large. So I will end by referring to an analysis that has been done by other people where they try different filters, and these are the different filters that are reported in this publication. And the problem is that they use a naive Kalman filter, which is here in orange with respect to the data we got from some wastewater treatment plant. And the blue line is the one that we are able to propose with our forward, backward, adapted filter, taken into account also different data that they didn't take into account, like the volume, etc. And you see that there is a much nicer behavior of the Aubépine filter with respect to the naive filter. So they didn't look at in their publication to our Aubépine filter. And of course, now they are interested to do so. We have a collaboration at the international level with the people in NIB in Slovenia, and where we were able to treat the wastewater and propose the envelope of the data out of their measurements. And this has been done in these cities. And we are continuing now to look at the correspondence between our indicator and the true value that is available, the incidence rate, and compare the analogies and the differences between the two indicators. We have also collaboration in England with the UK Government of Wastewater COVID-19 monitoring system. And we are, of course, also open with collaboration with other countries like in Greece, like in Japan, and maybe others if they are willing. So this is the end of my presentation, and I am open to questions. I thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Yvon, for this very nice, very interesting presentation. Are there any questions, please? Don't hesitate, raise your hand and...
Yes, I have a question.
Okay.
From Jacques de Monchot.
Please.
Are you able to forecast for a week with a good precision from the past data? What is the state of forecasting?
Alors, the state of forecasting is not so reliable. We are working on it. And so for this, now we've only statistical tools. We propose an indication on what will be the next measurements. As I told you, we get measurements twice a week, so it is not a forecasting on 1 week, but 3 to 4 days. It's quite good, but it has to be complemented with other tools. You may know that I've been working on the forecasting of the epidemic, not in the wastewater, where through tools of reduced basis techniques and averaging, we were able to forecast on 2 weeks. Mm-hmm. Now, in order to be able to apply this to the wastewater analysis and the forecasting, we need to have a major ingredient that is missing for the moment, is what is the concentration in the stool. And this is very difficult because you are able to get the concentration and the evolution of the concentration in the excretion in the mouth, in the nose, but what you see in the wastewater is not coming from there, and there are very few contributions, and it's really a nightmare to be able to conduct, in France at least, and also maybe in other countries, to know what the people are excreting in the stool. And due to this, it's difficult to relate what is the level of the epidemic with respect to what you find in the wastewater treatment plant. It is missing, and we would like also to have a digital twin out of the wastewater, and it is for the moment quite difficult. We tried to evaluate this from inverse problem, because it is the convolution from the epidemiologic level to what you find in the wastewater. It is a convolution with the expression curve. But as you know, deconvoluting is not a well-posed problem, and with the noise that we get, it's quite difficult to get something which is quite reliable.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
So, thank you. Maybe Andrea Pugliese, please.
Thanks for the talk, it was quite interesting. First, a very simple question. When you talk of light that is positive, What do you mean? What is comes first? The measure in the wastewater or the
wastewater? Yeah, the positive is wastewater.
Okay.
And so in most of
wastewater first, okay.
And in most of the treatment plants, it is positive.
Okay. And then another more curiosity. You showed this nice correlation between incidence and levels in the wastewater. Does it change in time to describe how the reporting rate changes, or perhaps in this last wave is different than in the previous one, the level?
So actually, as you know, there has been an explosion of the number of individual testing this last month or so. And so this is something that we are currently trying to get. It's a little bit difficult because so we have one major difficulty in France is that Santé Publique France that is hosting all these data doesn't believe too much in what is in the wastewater. And so we are only able to get the incidence rate at in the perimeter of the wastewater treatment plant, which is called in French the bassin versant. I don't know exactly the translation in English, but we are not able to get in each collectivity that we are following, the 200 collectivities, we are not able to get the incidence rate related to the population in the basin of attraction of each wastewater treatment plant. So we are trying to discuss with them in order to be able to do so. So this is a work under investigation. But from what we see between the on the big cities where it is available, there is really a difficulty in order to provide the right incidence rate from data that have been multiplied by the factor of 10 from one month and a half ago to now, where the number is completely ridiculous. And so in order to get a reliable picture of what is the situation at the level of collectivity from the individual testing is really a challenge. Here, since March 2020, we are using the same concentration and the same tool, and we are able really to compare what arrived in the first, the second, and now the fifth and sixth wave of the Omicron.
Okay, Andrea, is that okay? Maybe some problem with the mic.
Yeah, everything fine. Yes, thank you.
Okay, so now we get a question from Luis Alvarez. Can you ask your question directly, or do you want me to ask it for you?
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Thank you for the presentation. Very nice. I wonder, how do you get the real value for comparison?
It is a fake. It is a fake example. The true value for comparison. What we did here is a fake. It is something that we constructed. Okay, and then we took the true value, which is on a virtual wastewater treatment plant. Okay, and we pollute the heat with noise. And with limit of detection, and we randomly selected values that are aberrant, erroneous.
Okay, thank you. Okay. And in general, can we expect to get the epidemic trend modification sooner using the wastewater than the incident rate?
Yes, this is what I try to explain when we look at the lag in between. When we do this analysis where we compare the curve, so here it is the decay, but we did also the same when we start to change the tendency when it start to increase. And for instance, if you look at what was in the situation in June 2020, we were able to see in June the increase in the wastewater, and it was accepted from the individual testing and the incidence rate only mid-August. So we had 4 weeks of advance in the tendency just because people were not tested in June and July. And so you couldn't see from the individual testing that were very too small. Okay. It was more based on the hospitalization. And actually, when we went and see the sanitary agencies and say, look at what is arriving in the wastewater treatment plant, the concentration is increasing, they didn't believe us, okay, at that time. Now they believe us, okay? And now, for instance, when we said starting in September that the decay was a change and we were getting in a new wave, we had people at the agencies, sanitary agencies, that with whom we are discussing almost every week, that were taking this into account. So when the level of circulation is low, we can have 2 to 3 weeks advance with respect to the individual testing. At the top, the advance is a few days generally, in average.
Okay, thank you. Very interesting.
You're welcome.
Okay, any more questions? Actually, I have one. I want to know, could you go back to the formula you are using for the Kalman filter? I want to make sure I understand something.
Okay.
Maybe it's too far away.
No, it's là, c'est bon.
Ah, yes. So if I understood well from what you said at the end, you got several type of formula here, right? People are using different type of formula for this. The second part is about, so you got a sort of linear, affine model. By the way, the eta and the delta there might depend on the iteration, right?
They are constant for the moment.
Ah, they are constant. Ah, okay. Yeah.
Okay.
Ah, okay. So it's really the increase and the decrease are really due to the stochasticity or something like that, right?
Exactly. Yeah.
Oh, I see. And the y part is corresponding to
the measurements. Okay.
Ah.
So xi is exactly what we can see.
Okay.
Epsilon is the noise. So you see that the true value is polluted with a noise.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
And in addition, we have the limit of detection.
Okay. Sounds clear. So people are using, you mentioned several types of Kalman filter, means people are using different such a type of model or what?
So the model is the same, but what we do here is the forward-backward Kalman smoothing and taking into account.
You get another, I don't know anything about Kalman filter actually. So so it means that you get an extra methodology.
Yes. An extra methodology taken into account the fact that we don't have data every day. So the true process is underlying every day, but the measurements are not taken every day, and the measurements are polluted, and so we have the possibility of getting erroneous data and data under the limit of detection.
Okay, thank you.
You see the difference here between the two red curves.
Yeah.
A classical Kalman filter backward forward, but not taken into account the limit of detection. It means that the value should be below. And what we get here, where we are able, even though the limit of detection is at 20, we are able to propose concentration that are below the 20.
Okay. No, sounds really good, really interesting. Any more questions?
Yes, a question. Are you amplifying systematically the same fragment of RNA?
It is based as is written here on the E and RDRP.
Yes, but it's good for incidence. Have you tried to retropredict, for example, the curve of the death?
No.
Because for the death, possibly the fragment, if you are looking at the literature, could be not taken by chance, but there is some fragment probably related to the pathogenicity. Because here, it's perhaps only linked to the contagiosity of the virus, but you know the contagiosity is not exactly the virulence, but certain fragments could be more related to the virulence and hence to the occurrence of death.
Yes, but at this level, we are not really able to do this. So we are testing the E and RDRP to quantify the virus, whatever variant it is. But in order to characterize the variants, we do two kinds of things. The RT-PCR, in order to characterize, for instance, for the alpha, the deletion 6970, etc., for the other variants. And we are also doing sequencing. Mm-hmm. But the difficulty here is that, contrarily to individual testing, the sequence that we get of gene are A, completely of different kinds. And when you test generally in one person, you have one, maybe two variants, but you have not a multiplicity of genes that are arriving. And in with the wastewater, of course, you have a large number of things like this. And also the gene is not complete. Okay, we have bits of genes because during the process, from your toilets to the wastewater treatment plants, the gene is degraded, okay, degraded in French. And so what arrives is not a complete gene, it's little bits of gene. So we have to recompose the variant by adapted methods, and actually there will be a study continuing on this. We have started with a master thesis that will continue with a PhD thesis in order to be able to, from the sequencing, to get accurate information, to get the proportion of variant, and maybe to select and to detect the apparition of new variants.
What is very interesting for testing the pathogenicity is the most frequent fragments, because the long fragments are not dangerous, but the small fragments of length between 20 and 30 okay. could play the same role as the macroRNA by hybridizing some messenger RNA belonging to important part of the metabolisms. And to identify fragments and calculate the frequency of these fragments could be very important to predict and study in general the pathogenicity. And if you had the possibility to keep in memory what fragments are the more frequent, could be very important for the future.
Ah, okay, thank you. Mm. Okay.
Yeah, you can read a paper which will appear in Virology probably this week. And if you want some information, some additional information, I can send you.
Okay, yes, thank you. Yeah, that would be interesting. And actually, we get many kinds of sample of different variants. So what you say here might be possible. Because we really have a mixture of every genes.
Yeah, this knowledge is very important for me.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Yvon, for this very nice presentation. And I think we can...
You're welcome. Thank you for your attention and your questions.
I think we can stop here. And nothing has been planned yet for next month, but we try to organize some more talks later on, okay? Okay, so bye-bye, everybody.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.